If you're going to live a wise life, if you're going to have a heart that discerns, you need to understand anger. You have to understand how to understand and handle anger, not only in yourself, but in other people as well. First of all, it's dangerous power. Anger is an explosive, literally. It's the dynamite of the soul. And as a result, anger has the power to disintegrate things, to pulverize things like an explosive. First of all, it can disintegrate your body. A quick-tempered man displays folly. Tranquil heart is life to the body, but passion is rottenness to the bones. Nothing rots your bone, disintegrates your body like anger. Secondly, anger doesn't only disintegrate the body, but also community. A hot-tempered man stirs up dissension. When you get angry, you throw words around like weapons. They have an enormous amount of damaging power, and they wound people, they wound relationships, they destroy relationships. Very often you can never get them back. Anger, third of all, disintegrates your wisdom, that is, your ability to make wise choices at all. A patient man has great understanding, but a quick-tempered man displays folly. After you've cooled off, when you think of the things you said, when you think of the things you've done, after you've been angry and you've cooled off, don't you feel like a fool? You know why you feel like a fool? Because you were a fool. When you get angry, it distorts your view of things, your view of the situation, your view of yourself, your view of the world, your view of others, so that you make stupidly destructive choices. It actually destroys your will. It actually destroys your ability to make intelligent choices at all. Hot-tempered man must pay the penalty. If you rescue him, you will have to do it again and again and again. Of all the emotions, anger is the one most like an addictive substance. It's because anger leads you to denial. You can admit you're worried. You can admit you're sorrowful. You can admit everything but anger. Anger hides itself. Anger, like an addictive substance, leads you into denial. You say, "Oh, I'm not angry. I'm just sticking up for myself. I'm just getting it off my chest. I'm just an activist. I'm just looking out for justice. I'm just a direct speaker. I tell it like it is. I rock the boat." Because you deny your anger, you can have anger. And the more angry you are, the more these problems, social and psychological problems, show up. The more that happens, in order to keep up the fiction that you haven't induced these problems yourself, you have to be even more angry. You have to be angry at people who let this go wrong and people who do that. In order to stay in denial about how angry you are and how much your anger is the root of your problems, you have to get even angrier. The more you are angry, the more you need to be angry, and the more you will be angry. You lose control. Proverbs doesn't just tell us about it's a dangerous power. On the other hand, Proverbs says some astounding, the Bible says astoundingly positive things about anger, because according to the Bible, anger is basically a good thing. He who is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and he who rules his spirit than he who captures a city. The ideal in Proverbs, the ideal in the Bible, is not no anger or blowing up anger. It's slow anger. It is a sin to never get angry. It's a sin to blow up with your anger. According to the Bible, the ideal is slow anger. He that is angry without cause sins. But he who is not angry when there is cause sins. For unreasonable patience is the hotbed of many vices. Slow to anger, which is the mark of the wise person here, is an attribute of God. The Bible again and again says God is slow to anger. But if you have a God who never gets angry, you can't have a God of love, because if you never, ever get angry about anything, you don't love anything. Because if you love and you see the thing you love threatened, you're angry. If you're indifferent, you're not in love. Think how we feel when we see someone we love ravaged by unwise actions or relationships. Do we respond with benign tolerance as we might toward strangers? Far from it. Anger isn't the opposite of love. Hate is. And the final form of hate is indifference. The more a father loves his son, the more he's angry at the drunkard, the liar, the traitor in the son. True love always gets angry. In fact, we can even be stronger than that. Love, in its uncorrupted origin, is just love moved to deal with a threat to someone you love. You know what anger is? In its original, you know what anger is? In its pure form, the way it's supposed to be? Anger is love in motion toward a threat to that which you love. If something you really love is threatened, you get angry at the thing that's threatening it. And that's why anger pulverizes. That's the reason anger disintegrates. It disintegrates the thing that's endangering that which you love. You know, anger originally was a form of love. And that means that if you look at the things in your heart that most anger you and then ask this question, what am I defending? Look at the things that that get you the most angry and say, what are you defending? And you have an answer to the things your heart loves the most. The answer is the things your heart loves the most. And that's the reason why when the Bible says God is angry all the time, it's because he loves us. And he's angry at sin that's destroying the human race which he made, and he loves with his whole being. And if you look at Jesus, who the Bible continually says is perfect, you'll see him getting angry. Why would Jesus Christ get so angry? Because he's a man of love, of perfect love, of pure love. That's why he's getting angry. He gets angry, but he sins not. The Bible has a unique approach. It sees its basic goodness and yet its destructive and dangerous power. How does anger, or why does anger go wrong? Do not testify against your neighbor without cause, or use your lips to deceive. Do not say, I'll do to him as he has done to me. I'll pay that man back for what he did. Look at verse 29. Somebody is really angry at someone. But verse 28 says that in spite of the fact that you're angry, you don't have just cause for that anger. Our anger is disordered. And Augustine said the biggest problem we have is disordered loves. Disordered loves means there are many things in this world that are good. Your family, or your job, or your a political cause, or your accomplishments, or your mate, or whatever. There are many good things. There are many things in this world that are good, but we turn good things into ultimate things. We don't just love things that are good. But we look to certain things to give us the happiness and the significance and security and self-worth that only God can do. And when we turn good things into ultimate things, when we love good things too much, more than God, that's when our emotions get absolutely distorted. You've got to have it. That's the only way you'll be happy. And when that happens, when you turn a good thing into an ultimate thing, when you love something and look to something in a way you should only look to God, that's when your emotions are totally off over the top. That's when they're completely magnified and completely uncontrollable. They're completely disproportionate. That's what happens. Now, let's apply this to anger. If it's true that anger was originally just a form of love, disordered love creates disordered anger. And our anger is disordered in three ways. First of all, anger is disordered in its cause. See, there's nothing wrong with being ticked, getting angry to a degree, if somebody slights your reputation. But why are you 10 times, 100 times more angry about it than some horrible, violent injustice being done to people in another part of the world? You know why? St. Augustine said, here's why. Because you may believe in God, but if God's love is an abstraction, if what you're really looking for your significance and security is people's approval or a good reputation or status or something like that, then when anything gets between you and the thing that you have to have, you become implacably angry. You have to have it. You're over the top, so you can't shrug it off. And as a result, our causes, we get angry over causes that there's certain things that can make us incredibly angry when the cause really would be warranting only a little bit of anger. And there are other causes that, for which we ought to be incredibly angry, but because of our selfishness and our pride and our ego and our disordered loves, we're hardly angry at all. Secondly, our anger is not only distorted in terms of its cause, it's distorted in terms of its proportion. It's always over the top, uncontrollable. And thirdly, it's disordered with regard to its goal. And see, there's levels to our disorder. There's levels to it. What do I mean by levels? Well, what I mean is, at the level one, there's things that just bug us every day, things that make us angry. Level two, there are betrayals and injustices and letdowns that we haven't forgotten. We haven't forgotten them. We haven't been able to totally forgive them. And you know what? Level two leads to more level one anger. If you're a man and a woman has wronged you and you haven't totally forgiven that woman, you're going to be more quick to be angry at other women. You're going to be quicker to take slights from women than men. If you are a member of a particular race or class and you were wronged by a person in another race or class and you haven't totally forgiven, that creates an anger level. Level two, it's under the surface that it makes you more prone to take slights and offense and get angry at people of that race or that class. And underneath the whole thing, there's a low level of anger toward God himself. You see, if you build your life on things, I'll be happy if I have a family, I'll be happy if I have a job, I'll be happy if I have a life like this or like that, and life never gives us the things that we are building our happiness on, then there's a low level, a bedrock of self-pity and anger against life and God that makes it hard to forget wrongs, That's level two, and makes it therefore easier to be slighted at level one, which of course creates fodder for level two and level three. And on we go. Anger is at the bottom of so many of our problems in this world, so many of your psychological problems, and you deny it because you don't admit it, because it's the one emotion that most leads to denial. And it leads to wars, and it leads to oppression, and it leads to so much of the misery in this world. How do we heal it? Three things you have to do. The first thing you must do is admit it. You have to own your anger. You have to admit your anger. You have to be in touch with your anger. You have to know how angry you are. It's absolutely critical. Let me tell you what happens if you will not admit your anger, if you disguise it from yourself, if you deny it, if you hide it. When someone wrongs you, you come after them, and here's what you say. You deserve anger, but I'm not angry. Now, you know what you're really doing? You're saying, you deserve anger, but I'm above you. You know, I'm too far above you to let you make me mad. But you, so of course, you really are angry. Because you're just punishing them, you're making them feel bad. But do you know that even if you're the victim, even if you have been wronged, to even admit you're angry is an act of vulnerability. Come to somebody and say, you made me angry, even if they're completely in the wrong, gives the possibility of reconciliation because you're admitting your weakness and then they can admit their weakness. But no, not if you won't admit or own your anger. If you just criticize people and you will not own up to your anger, you not only destroy the ability to reconcile, but meanwhile, you're feeding your level two. You are being angry. You're creating a root of bitterness, but roots become shoots, become trees, become forests. And if you will not admit your anger, you will be utterly controlled by it. The second thing you have to do is analyze it. Do not say, I'll do to him as he has done to me. I'll pay that man back for what he did. Now, who's this person talking to? That's self-talk. And here's the implication of this verse. What makes you angry is not what's happened to you, but what you tell yourself about what's happened to you. What makes you angry is not what you've lost, but what you say to yourself that means. It's not that somebody is holding something away from you that makes you angry. It's if you say, I've got to have that, I've got to have that, or my life is a ruin. See, your anger comes from what you believe, not from what people are doing to you. You've got to know that. Whenever you get angry, say, what is this big thing that's so important to me that I'm defending? What is this big thing that is so important to me that I'm willing to clobber everybody around me so I get it, rather than lose it? Now, if you ask that question, more often than not, almost immediately, if you do this analysis, you'll immediately be embarrassed because many, many times the thing you're defending is your ego, your pride, your self-esteem. There's a place in the book of Jeremiah, there's a place where God says, seekest thou great things for thyself? Seek them not. Use that on yourself in times like that. What you do as soon as you say, seekest thou great things for thyself? Seek them not. Your anger gets handleable. But sometimes to ask that analysis question is a lot more complicated because it can take you to the very roots of your life and your soul. So you have to admit it, you have to analyze it, but thirdly, you have to transform it. A gentle answer turns away wrath. If someone comes up to you with a harsh word, respond gently. And look at the last two verses. If you have an enemy, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him drink. This is not just saying, don't revenge yourself on your enemies. This is saying, save your enemies. I mean, you know, food and drink, these are things you can't live without. Redeem your enemies. But the way to do a surgical strike, the way to target, not the person, but the problem, not the idiot, but the idiocy, is you have to come in close and say, I'm going to insist gently on the truth. This is the way it is. This is what I'm going to tell you. This is how I'm going to. You have to come close. You have to insist on the truth. And you have to just absorb their anger without paying back. And if you do that, if you don't withdraw, you don't come in with guns blazing, but you just say very calmly, insisting on the truth, very gently insisting on the truth, this is how it's going to be. I know you're angry. I know you're upset, but this is just what we're going to do, and this is how it's going to be. And if you just absorb the pain of their disordered rage without paying back, you can save your child. Now, do you realize what God has done? We are mad at him. You don't want to admit you're mad at God, but that's right, because people in anger always deny it. We want this and we want that and we wanted this and we want that and God hasn't given it to us and we are mad. We're in denial, but the proof that we are mad at him, and it's the most unjustified, the most disordered, the most hurtful possible rage, but the proof that it's there was that when God became human, when he became vulnerable, when he became killable, we killed him. When he got within our clutches, we took hold of him. We took him to the cross and we mocked him. We beat him, we tortured him, we reviled and he did not revile again. What was he doing? We were angry at God. God didn't withdraw, and he didn't come in guns blazing. He went to the cross, and on the cross, he told us the truth and absorbed our disordered rage without paying back. And he didn't just take our undeserved anger. He also took the anger we deserved without paying back. The gentlest word, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. if you see Jesus Christ. He loved the sinner and hated the sin. He forgave our sins so he could embrace the sinner. And if you are melted by the knowledge, stunned into silence by how he responded to our disordered rage, then when other people wrong you, you can do the same. You can say, hey, I've been wronged, but I wronged God. And at infinite cost, he responded with cosmic gentleness, and I can't do anything other than that.